The whole human life is based on two major criteria. One is fixed and stable, what we call constant, and second is ever moving and growing. The ever moving and growing area or the criterion is known as advancement. Advancement has no boundaries and limits. And the constant thing is the minimum or basic requirement of life. So we have basic requirement as one substratum, and the parallel ring as advancement, which is endless. Even though if we are advanced or not, we should have at least the minimal requirement for life. Whenever somebody is subjected to any disease, who is very mobile, capable, very executive, very knowledgeable, if the person is put in ICU, the minimal requirement that we will demand from the operation authorities, that is the doctors, is at least they should survive. Apart from that, the person growing young or remaining ever young or very energetic or comparatively more energetic or becoming a superhero, these things are advancements. At least he should survive is the basic requirement. Likewise, just as mere survivement is required for human survival, just as at least food, shelter and clothing is to be handled to the people who are there, the citizens of the nation or the global area, that is a minimal requirement for the whole global existence and system of life. Survival is the basic of life. Food, shelter and clothing is the minimal assurance we should be given to the citizens of the world. Likewise, there is a basic criteria which is a characteristic assurance for the whole world. It is known as ahimsa. Whether you are helping others or not, whether you are working with others or not, whether you are embracing everybody brotherhood or not, at least you should not harm the people. So, just as survival for human body, food, health, clothes and shelter for human composite social survival, ahimsa is the basic minimal requirement for global functioning. At least you should not disturb people, whether you contribute something towards them, whether you are going to live with them for so many advanced benefits. So, the minimal requirement for global collective existence is ahimsa. So it starts with na himsa vidyate yatra sa ahimsa. It means do not cause suffering to anybody. Suffering may be physical, it may be mental, it may be intellectual, it may be spiritual. But basically it starts with two things. One is physical suffering and second is a mental suffering. And this suffering has a range. It is known as a range of violence. Starting from nuisance. Starts with nuisance. What is nuisance? Undue interference into a person's sleep, work, rest and privacy. Somebody is working, you should not intrude. Somebody is taking rest, you should not intrude. Somebody is living in peace, you should not intrude. So work, rest, sleep, action and each and everybody's privacy should not be interfered by anybody else. This is nuisance. Even a small nuisance is ahimsa. It is a droplet of ahimsa. And giving tension, threat, torture and other things, that is a stream of ahimsa. And flood of ahimsa is brutality, mass genocide, there are various other wars and conflicts, communal clashes, terrorism, these things are like floods. So there is a droplet of ahimsa starting from nuisance, being broader enough to go into a stream of ahimsa in the form of tension, terror, horror, threat and torture, and also ending in a torrential flood of ahimsa in the form of genocide, homicide, untold miseries of terrorism and other things. So, this is known as the range of violence. So, starting from harming a person's privacy till killing a person or a group of person or targeting a mass, everything is encompassed or targeted or covered within the ambit of the ahimsa. So, ahimsa means it should not be even at the minimal most present. Starting from the most infinitesimal as well as the considerable stage, ahimsa should not be done at any level, to any level of person, on any ground of his efficacy and functioning of the society. So ahimsa is fully complete. And ahimsa has so many other dimensions also. Even though if you are not going to do ahimsa, if you delegate somebody to do ahimsa, that is also ahimsa. Even if you are also observing non-violence, Your duty is to extend your office or extend your motto to others, to teach and preach others. Likewise, if you are doing violence, and if you are not doing violence as well as instigating, provoking, or channelizing or leading the people in such a way that they will be provoked into violence, that is also offensive. So there are four other modes of violence. One is delegative violence, in which you lead others so that in your leadership or under your speech and direction they are going for this violence. That is known as delegative. And the second thing is responsible. A government, a ruler, an administrator, whether they are indulging in violence or not, wherever violence happens within the area of administration or jurisdiction, they are responsible for that. So people not doing violence, but still under their leadership, if anybody commits violence, they are also partner of it. Number two, in the jurisdiction and administrative ambit, if something is done, they are responsible for that. It is known as violence on responsibility. Second is violence on delegation. Then third is violence on non-relief. As a human being, even though if you are not harming anybody, if you are not preventing the person from being harmed from other people, then you are also a partner of that violence. So violent, non-violence means it does not mean that don't harm anybody. Even if you see somebody harming somebody else, as a human being, having a common species spirit, you have to rush for the help. If you are not doing, you are getting the liability of non-relief pattern of violence. That is known as non-relief pattern. So if you are not relieving people from their problems, number one, if you are not guiding people properly, if your delegations, they are authoritatively, they are responsible for that, if you are having administrative responsibility, you are said to be violent. So violence is not only an individual quality, you have to see that your responsible dependents, they are to be non-violent. And you have to prevent violence whenever you have to see. So this is known as composite study of ahimsa, wherein by mere restraint from violence, it does not mean non-violence. In the Vedic scope of violence, whether you are doing, whether you are seeing, whether you are authorizing, whether you are not relieving the person, whether you are responsible there to do that impact, if you are refraining from your duty, you are responsible, you get more punishment than the person who directly indulges in the ahimsa method. So these are all the various things. And ahimsa has one more dimension. The best tool in ahimsa is patience and forgivingness. What is the beauty, what is the ornament of ahimsa? Non-violence means it should have two major dimensions. Two ornaments of ahimsa is, one is patience, you have to wait. And second thing, you must see that you must also know how to excuse things within the limit. It is known as pattern zone. What is the limitation for pattern? Whenever a person, number one, is ready to compensate, if it is compensatable, if the person is ready to compensate, number one. Number two, if he avoids repetition of the mistake, if he has repentance for the mistake, then the pardon zone can be executed. So excuse can be given only in some areas to some mistakes, because if you are not to be violent, certainly you have to excuse the people. If you have to excuse the people should be worthy of the excuse. Excuse should extinguish a person's committing of mistakes. If you excuse a person, forgiving a person should extinguish the flame of corruption or flame of sin inside him. If you are excusing a person which fuels and manages the person's habitual mistake, that type of excuse is very dangerous, and that ahimsa is not properly administered. So wherever you have to battle people, number one, repentance. Number two, avoidance of repetition of the mistake, and compensation should be assured. Patience and forgiving, they are the ornaments of the so-called ahimsa. Apart from your ahimsa, wherein by you practice ahimsa, you have other additional work also. One, teaching ahimsa. Number two, training ahimsa. You have to teach ahimsa. Already if the people are qualified and having a spirit of ahimsa inside, teaching is enough. If they need more messages, you have to train them. Mere teaching will not work out. So teach ahimsa, train ahimsa, demonstrate as an exemplary model so that seeing you they can be inspired and they can practice ahimsa. Prevent himsa and protect people who are subjected to himsa, and also say that you can captivate those people who are against ahimsa so that they can be directly or indirectly punished by mass protest, self non-violent measures and agitations, judicial proceedings and democratic methodologies. So prevent, to protect, to teach, to train, to demonstrate, always to punish wherever it is possible and forgive wherever the pardon zone is executable. These are all various dimensions of ahimsa. Three types of golden rules of ahimsa I want to say, which are the quotations from Shastras. If a person is not harming other people,